The abstractions that the transport layer provides are endpoint, transport, channel, and connection. And I'll talk about each of these things in a little bit more detail. Endpoint, you can think of as nothing but a protection domain, or you can say it is a Java virtual machine. And it has a table of remote objects that it can access. And so this gives you a protection domain or a sandbox for execution of a server code or a client code can exist within the sandbox. That's what endpoint is. It's basically a protection domain. Connection management is the interesting piece that worries about all of the details of connecting these endpoints together. And in particular, the connection management of the transport layer of the Java runtime system is responsible for setting up connections, tearing down connections, listening for incoming connections, and establishing the connection. And when a connection is established between two endpoints, this abstraction that I mentioned called transport comes into play. So, for instance, between this endpoint and this endpoint, the connection manager decided to have UDP transport. So a channel is established between this endpoint and this endpoint to do UDP transport between these two endpoints. And so this is the functionality of the UDP transport that is incorporated in this transport layer. And similarly, between this endpoint and this endpoint, the connection manager decided to use a TCP channel. So the transport that is being used here is a TCP connection, both ends. We have a TCP connection at both ends to connecting this endpoint with this endpoint. Notice that a given endpoint can have different transport for talking to different endpoints depending on a variety of parameters. What is the best way for this endpoint to talk to this endpoint may decide what kind of connection this endpoint is going to establish with this endpoint. That is all part of connection management that is happening in the transport layer of the Java runtime. And the connection manager is also responsible for locating the dispatcher for a remote method that is being invoked on this endpoint. So a transport is listening on a channel, and when an invocation comes in, then this transport is responsible for identifying or locating the dispatcher on this domain, which will know how to carry out that invocation. And the connection manager is also responsible for monitoring the liveness of the connection, because if an endpoint goes away, it needs to know that and inform this domain that, oh, this particular endpoint is gone, so take the appropriate action. So that kind of liveness monitoring is part of connection management. So the last abstraction I mentioned is the notion of connection itself. So once a channel has been established, then the transport can do I/O on this channel using connection. So the path for the transport layer is in connection management. It listens for an incoming request. When an incoming request comes in, it then establishes a channel. And the channel that is established for communication, which is a mutual agreement between these two endpoints, it chooses the transport that is most appropriate for that. And once the channel has been established, a connection is now made between this endpoint and this endpoint through this channel. And now these two endpoints can do I/O on the channel using the connection. So that's how the transport mechanism of RMI works. As we saw, the transport mechanism sits below the RRL layer, and so it allows all the object invocations to happen through the transport layer. And the RRL layer is the one that is deciding what is the right transport to use depending on the location of the two endpoints, where the client is and where the server is. Depending on that, it might decide what may be the right transport to use, whether it should use TCP or UDP and so on, and gives that command to the connection manager, which is part of the transport layer of the software stack, so that the established channel can be established and then a connection can be used for actual transport of the invocation between the client and the server. So in summary, the distributed object model of Java is a powerful vehicle for constructing network services. And what we saw in this lesson is a glimpse of the classes that are available in the distributed object model that makes the life of the developer easy in terms of creating network objects and making it visible for clients to use anywhere, and the power of the RRL layer in dynamically deciding how to make the client-server relationship similar to the subcontract mechanism that we saw in Spring. And we also saw the flexibility in the connection management, allowing different kinds of transport to exist between the client and the server, depending on the location of the client and network conditions and so on.